Now it's my pleasure to introduce the first speaker, who is Professor Leila Belkhir. I guess you know her quite well because she was very present in the media over the last months. I had the pleasure to meet her before at the presentation of a thesis, and I discovered a very interesting person. And we all noticed from the laboratory point of view that she took the defense of all health workers, including the people working in the laboratory. And only clinician that was interested about our problem. So, Leila Belkhir, thank you for shutting down your microphone, please. Leila Belkhir is infectiologist in the Clinique Universitaire Saint-Luc, and she is also associate professor in the University of UCL. She is working in the AIDS Reference Center and also has an interest in TBM for drugs used against AIDS. So, Leila, thank you very much for joining us, and please, we are listening to the presentation. Thank you.
Everybody, thank you. First of all, thank you for this invitation, and thank you, Frederick, for this kind introduction. So, is it okay for you? I don't know. Do you see? It's okay. So, I will speak about the COVID-19 and about a little bit about puzzles and mysteries. But I will try to give you some explanation, of course, as a clinician. So, I wanted to start with this: once upon a time, maybe a Prince Charming. But no, unfortunately, just a virus called SARS-CoV-2. So before speaking about the disease, it's important to understand a little bit the virus. So you all know that the story of COVID-19 started in December 2019 with undiagnosed pneumonia coming from China. A few weeks later, WHO says that the new China coronavirus could spread and warns hospital worldwide. And you remember the sequences with the public health emergency declared on January and 2 months later, the pandemic. And unfortunately, it's still the same story at this moment. So the SARS-CoV-2 belongs to the coronavirus. Coronaviruses are spherical positive single-stranded RNA viruses. They are characterized by a crown-like structure like this with the spike protein. They belong to the largest genomes of all RNA viruses, and their genome are more than three times as big as of HIV and HCV and more than twice influenzas. They have a genomic proofreading mechanism. It's important because it keeps the virus from accumulating mutation that could weaken it. And another particular thing, they frequently recombine, sharing parts of RNA with other coronaviruses. And this recombination can lead to versions that infect easily new cell types and jump to other species. And so you know that there is four coronaviruses that cause common colds. It's frequent and frequent in our climate. But there are now three that cause severe diseases, and they all came from bats. The SARS-CoV, the first one, the cause of severe acute respiratory syndrome in 2002-2003. The MERS-CoV, the cause of Middle East respiratory syndrome with it has a higher mortality rate. It's from 2012, and now the SARS-CoV-2, previously named the 2019 new coronavirus. So the origin of SARS is still an open question. The all viruses initially existed in bats, you can see here, all came from bats, and they acquired mutation to adapt and to come into intermediate host and after to jump into humans. But the intermediate host here, you can see it was, for example, the sequence for the SARS-CoV, the camel for the MERS, and we think that it could maybe be the pangolin for the SARS-CoV-2. But it's still an open question. And so the common point is that the coronaviruses have been demonstrated to be able to adapt quickly and cross the species barrier as the resulting epidemic or pandemic. The SARS-CoV and the novel SARS-CoV-2 share almost 80% of sequence identity. But compared to SARS-CoV, the SARS-CoV-2 infection is characterized by a wider clinical spectrum. We will speak about that after, including asymptomatic infection, mild upper respiratory tract illness, severe viral pneumonia, and for some, unfortunately for some patients, respiratory failure and death. The receptor binding domain of SARS-CoV-2 has a higher ACE2 binding affinity compared to the first SARS-CoV, and it maybe could lead to a more efficient cell entry. And another difference is between the three SARS, between the three coronaviruses, is that the SARS-CoV-2 has the highest transmissibility, followed by SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV. And so these differences between the SARS could explain the spectrum of the disease. And just to remind the physiopathology, the SARS-CoV-2 bind to the host cell via the spike 1 protein and trough the ACE2 receptor. After that, there is a fusion with the between the viral envelope and the cellular membrane. The virus uses the cell machinery, you know that. But the problem is here with the inflammatory response, because some people will have a healthy inflammatory response, and a few person will have an uncontrolled immune response with cytokine storm, for example, interleukin 6, the high level of CRP also, and it leads to an hyperactivation of macrophage, monocyte, and so lung damage and multi-organ damage. And so the disease, we can resume that there is two phases, two important phases in the disease. The first one is the viremic phases, and some patients is characterized by a few symptoms or mild symptom, and some patients will develop a severe phase, a second phase, linked to a host inflammatory response with a dysfunction in the immune response. And as I told just previously, with excessive infiltration of monocyte, macrophage with a systemic cytokine storm, it can lead to pulmonary edema, pneumonia, and widespread inflammation and multi-organ damage. Before speaking about the clinical presentation, a few words about the transmission. You know that the reproductive number is between 1.4 and 3, so it's just higher than Ebola, but lower than the influenza virus. And as you know, the SARS-CoV-2 is mainly transmitted from human to human by infection respiratory droplet. You can see that. The droplets typically do not travel more than 2 meters. Infection can also occur by direct contact, but it's not all of the transmission. It's very, it causes just few transmission. But recently, other modes of transmission have been pinpointed. For example, the airborne transmission. And we know that the airborne transmission could appear mainly in poorly ventilated and enclosed spaces. For example, during short practice in restaurants or in classes. And so the risk of transmission from an individual with SARS-CoV-2 infection varies by the type and the duration of exposure, and of course, the use of preventive measures. There is another mystery about the transmission. It's what we call the super spreader. What does that mean, super spreader? So when a single person infects a large number of other people, or when a gathering is linked to a large number of cases, and we know that because we know that almost 80% of the transmission have been caused by only a small fraction of infectious individual, almost between 10 and 20%. And so instead of speaking about super spreader, we have to speak about super spreading events, because it's a combination between the capacity of some people to produce a higher percentages of aerosol versus respiratory droplets and a particular environment, for example, to be indoor in poorly ventilated room. But you all know that the importance of, I don't like the social distancing, I prefer physical distancing to protect other people. So now the clinical presentation. The spectrum of the disease is very particular in COVID-19 because there are a proportion of asymptomatic infection, and the reporting of this asymptomatic infection is estimated at 16%, but it ranges from 4% to 48%. It depends on the study. And the spectrum also of the symptomatic infection ranges from mild to critical, but fortunately, most of infection are not severe. The death is in approximately 0.4%, is higher than for the influenza, but among hospitalized patients, the proportion of critical or fatal disease is higher. You will see that after. The timeline of the symptom is very interesting also. We have an incubation period from 2 to 14 days, but usually 50% of the patient develop the first symptom after 5 days. Usually 1 week after symptom onset, almost 15% of the patient will develop a severe illness, leading them to the hospital. And the severity of the illness is characterized by a high respiratory frequency, dyspnea, a blood oxygen saturation below 93%, etc. And 5% of the patient will come into the disease with a critical illness characterized by respiratory failure, septic shock, and or multiple organ dysfunction or failure. And we observe that also in the hospital, usually the patient came in the hospital after 7 days, and 2 or 3 days after, for some of them, they will go to the ICU for acute respiratory distress syndrome. And so what about the symptom? So the mainly symptom are the cough, the fever, but the fever is more frequently present for the patient who came to the hospital, not for all the outpatients. Fever, cough, and shortness of breath is reported in 67% of patient. There are also some specific symptoms like fatigue, myalgia, headache, and for the more elderly patient, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting is also described. The loss of smell or taste is not very frequent in the hospitalized patient, but it's most described in the outpatient, so the patient with mild or moderate symptoms. I have a problem with my... Sorry, I have a problem. I can't move to the next slide. I don't know why. Okay. So you know that first of all, the COVID-19 is pneumonia. When people have a moderate or severe disease, it's a pneumonia. And here you will find an X-ray and a CT scan of one of our patients admitted in the first wave with peripheral extensive ground glass. You can see here opacities and a pleural here infusion, and with the lung infiltrate more than 75%. And so what are the major complications? Some of people will develop an acute respiratory distress syndrome, and this is the most and the major complication in patients with severe disease. And usually it comes after 8 days after the onset of the symptom. Some people, unfortunately, will develop a shock or a thromboembolic complication. And what about the mortality data? Here are the mortality data of Saint-Luc for the first wave. You can see that we have almost 20% of overall in hospital mortality. It's like in other part of Belgium, but in the ICU, the overall mortality is very higher, almost 40%, but it depends also of the series. The characteristic of the SARS-CoV-2 is that it can invade all the organs, the lungs, you know that, but also the heart, the blood vessels, the brain, the liver, the kidney, and the intestine, and it contributes to the large spectrum of the disease. For example, when we look at the heart and the COVID, there are some people will develop acute myocarditis, other people will develop acute myocardial infection, some people have acute heart failure, and dysrhythmia are also described. One of the major complications is also the venous thromboembolic event, because patients with COVID-19 are also at increased risk of a venous thromboembolism event, and this is part of the treatment. You will see that after, and it linked to the systemic inflammation, to the abnormal coagulation status, and it's more frequent for the critical illness, and all of these factors contribute to the increased risk of having thromboembolic event. And it was also first described in report with autopsy. But it's not all. There is also neurological system involvement with the COVID. Some patients have acute cerebrovascular disease. The impaired consciousness is described, and most frequently for the elderly patient. Guillain-Barré syndrome also have been described. And this syndrome is often present in patients with more severe COVID-19. The interesting thing, anosmia, is a direct neuroinvasion of the nervous system path, such as the olfactory bulb, and this attempt is significant for the mild syndrome. We have also a kidney injury. The kidney injury comes from mild proteinuria to progressive acute kidney injury, and some patients necessitate renal replacement therapy. It's interesting to know that the admission, more than 40% of patients have abnormal proteinuria at the admission, and 20% of patients admitted to the ICU require renal replacement therapy. And cardiovascular comorbidity, the sepsis, hypovolemia are factors that contribute to the kidney involvement. But the kidney involvement is multifactorial because there is also an endothelium damage by the virus. Cardiorenal syndrome also can cause the kidney damage, and the microemboli and microthrombi have been also described. And all of this so contribute to the mortality rate and mainly in hospitalized patients. And if we look at the risk factor of mortality, we see that the very strong predictor of mortality in hospital remained the increasing age. This is the data from Cienzano from Belgium, but there are also independent risk factor of hospital mortality, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, hypertension, chronic lung disease, cancer, and also obesity. Obesity was not described in the first report. It came from China, and it was mainly described when the disease appeared in Europe and in the USA. This is another report, not from Belgium, but from England, and we can see the same risk factor, the age, the obesity, diabetes, cancer, chronic respiratory disease, hypertension, etc. So the older age is an independent risk factor for mortality, and this is also the reported death in Belgium in the first wave, and you can see that more than 50% of the deceased patients were over 82 years old. If you look at the laboratory feature, there are also some laboratory features that are associated with the disease severity and the mortality. For example, lymphopenia, the elevation of the ferritin, the procalcitonin, the CRP. The live enzymes are frequently elevated, but there is no association with the disease severity. The LDH are also frequently elevated, but they have been associated with the disease severity and the mortality. Has the troponin, also the D-dimer, and the kidney involvement also. But it remains a very important question is why do people respond so differently? Because this is one of the most striking aspects of the COVID-19 is the stark differences in experiences of the disease. Because some people never develop symptoms, whereas others apparently healthy with no risk factor have severe or even fatal pneumonia. Maybe it's the viral load, or maybe it's genetic factor. The viral load have been linked to the severity of the clinical COVID-19. It was a report where they saw that the high viral load and the long virus shedding period was linked to the disease severity and the prognosis. But more recently, and there was also the team of ULB, they showed that more than 10% of people who developed severe COVID-19 had neutralizing antibodies against type 1 interferon at the onset of the infection. And these patients were aged from 25 to 87 years old, but most of them were men. Another interesting thing in the science also, it was that almost 4% of people who developed severe COVID-19 carry specific kind of genetic mutation that also interfere with the type 1 interferon immunity. And so genetic variation and autoantibodies then compromise this immunity, the immunity that depends of the interferon signaling, explain almost 15% of severe COVID-19. So maybe one mystery is being to be resolved. Another important question is when we have developed the disease, are we protected or not? You all have heard about this new cases report about reinfection. Recently, the ECDC made an assessment, a threat assessment brief concerning this reinfection. And more recently, The Lancet published a new report from reinfection in the USA. And so it's also a very important question because how well and how long the immune response protects the host from reinfection, and what do reinfection cases mean for the public health and the vaccination to stop this COVID-19 pandemic. Just a few words about the cases.
Ça travaille.
There is also...
sur le COVID, c'est intéressant.
There are 6 cases described. The first one was in Hong Kong with a 33-year-old man. But the second PCR was discovered in the airport, and because the patient was asymptomatic. In the USA, it's a 25-year-old immunocompetent man. The second reinfection was worse than the first because he had to be admitted in the hospital. And there is also a case of reinfection in Belgium with a 51-year-old woman taking oral corticosteroid, but for asthma. Other cases have been described in Ecuador and in India. And so it highlighted some questions because we don't know how often those reinfections happen and why. When reinfection happen, will this new case carry the same risk of transmission as the first infection? How do these cases factor into policies about screening people who have already recovered from COVID-19? And what are the implications for vaccine efficacy? If we have to resume these cases, all the 6 reported in reinfection were in relatively young and immunocompetent individuals. The clinical presentation in the reinfection episode differ. Across the 6 cases, some people were asymptomatic, others were symptomatic, and only one required a new hospitalization. And in the Hong Kong and the Ecuadorian case, the patient tested negative for IgG after the symptom onset of the first episode. And so what about the antibodies? Some data suggest that the antibodies level and the neutralizing antibodies in a high proportion of individuals who recover from SARS-CoV-2 infection, unfortunately, they start to decrease within 2 or 3 months after the infection. And they noted that among more than 90% of the patients, they observe a decline of antibodies, and they have the similar observation with the neutralizing antibodies. And so what do we know? We know that the protective role of antibodies or the T-cell induced immunity against SARS-CoV-2 is still not understood. The antibody titers are usually recognized as a reasonable correlate of antiviral immunity, but the magnitude of antibody response appears to be associated with disease severity, and maybe the patient with a mild disease, maybe they will not have a good immunity response. The most patients develop antibodies and neutralizing antibodies following the primary infection. These titers peak between 3 and 4 weeks, remain relatively stable up to 3-4 months after diagnosis, but unfortunately, neutralizing antibodies significantly decrease over time. And so, most patients do appear to mount an immune response following a first SARS-CoV-2 infection, but this immunity may wane over time, and it's more likely in individuals with a less severe primary infection. And so it's important to know that we cannot rely on immunity acquired by a natural infection to confer herd immunity. I think it's important to remind that. And last but not least, the treatment. You have all heard about the story of Raoult and the hydroxychloroquine. We had God Save the Queen and this last month, God Save the Chloroquine. But now I think that the story, we have the end of this story with the results of the recovery trial. and that demonstrate that the mortality at day 28 is similar in hydroxychloroquine patient compared to standard of care. So just one slide to conclude that now, at this moment, hydroxychloroquine, with or without azithromycin in Belgium, are not recommended anymore. And just to remind you, it was the treatment for during the first wave. We have also another story with the remdesivir. The remdesivir, the treatment prescribed to Donald Trump, as you know. Also, in this new report published in the New England Journal of Medicine, they show that there is a faster recovery in remdesivir treated hospitalized patients, 10 days instead of 14 days. But the benefit was most apparent in those COVID patients receiving oxygen. And the results were not conclusive for the other group. But it's important to remember that there is no statistical difference in the mortality by day 14 or by day 29. So there is an impact on the symptom and on the recovery, but not on the mortality. This is the Belgium guidelines, the last version, and so it's not usual, it's not frequent to use remdesivir. We can use remdesivir in adjunctive treatment if the patient is very critical and if the onset of symptom is less than 5 days. And so the treatment, there is a very big change in the treatment with the recovery trial and with the dexamethasone. So the guidelines now all agree to prescribe the dexamethasone for the severe patient, for the patient who need oxygen, because at this moment it's the only treatment who show a reduction of mortality among patients receiving oxygen or receiving invasive mechanical ventilation. And so this is now all our patients receive dexamethasone when they are hospitalized, when the symptom is the symptom onset is after 7 days, and when the patient need to receive oxygen. Another important part of the treatment is the anticoagulation management. It's very important to give anticoagulation for the patient hospitalized, but at the dose of thromboprophylaxis. I will just pass this slide, you will have it, but there is some guidelines to help us to prescribe the anticoagulation prophylaxis. Just a few words also about the oxygen. Oxygen is very important for the hospitalized patient, and in Saint-Luc and in other hospitals, we use also this double trunk mask. It's cheap, it's very effective to boost the fraction of inspired oxygen with a similar oxygen flow. And so it's simple, efficient, and it helps a lot of patients. So, we have speaking about the virus, about the clinical pictures, about the evolution of the transmission, the evolution concerning the treatment. And so after 10 months, there is still important mysteries about the coronavirus. And if we have to affront this second wave, do we need a superhero to fight this supervillain? I think no. I think that all the citizens now are the superhero, and as clinician and as person who work in hospital, I think we have to remember that and to tell that to the people, because we can control, we can help each other to control this pandemic with simple gestures, the hand hygiene, the face mask, and the physical distancing. And so, thank you for your attention and be safe.